Hello everyone, I'm Nathan Rich, also known as Hu Guo Da Wang. Last episode, we saw the British Empire go from antagonistically trading with the Qing to violently stopping its own merchants from trading. China had demanded they sign promises to not deal opium or face the legal consequences. Though some of the foreigners had noble intentions, the majority refused to subject themselves to the laws of China. The last thing they wanted was rule of law. And, having many opportunities to do so, instead of leaving, they began the process of China's subjugation with cannon fire. Opium had been officially banned and denounced by the emperor over a dozen separate times in less than 1 year. But the foreigners were not interested in Chinese laws, only in enforcing free trade. Under free trade, foreign merchants have the freedom to trade, and the local government loses its freedom to control the market. That's what all freedoms are, the transfer of rights from one entity to another. After the biggest drug bust in human history, tensions were high as the Qing did anything it could to make the British opium cartel representatives leave their lives of crime behind. The British had also tried to steal tea manufacturing secrets in the past, but it wasn't their clandestine intellectual property theft that made the Chinese try to expel them. They had tried to force the Qing into thousands of illegal trades, but it wasn't their incessant, arrogant, aggressive actions on the world stage that caused their expulsion either. They had forced their way into numerous countries, but it wasn't their widely known status as violators of contracts and international laws that tipped the scale either. They had become peddlers of artificially low-quality opium to the Qing subjects, but it wasn't their growing reputation as manufacturers of low-quality goods that angered the rulers of China. There was one single primary issue driving the Chinese to expel these foreigners: the issue of institutionalized illegal drug smuggling, the opium issue itself. The Qing had repeatedly tried to reason with the Lion, the British Empire. The holy men, emboldened by Christianity, standing on the backs of so many victimized countries, had been directly confronted with a plea: stop that illegal trade on the grounds of morality, if for nothing else. And with a cannon's flash, Britain had begun finally to answer the Celestial Empire's pleas. Now we will see how they birthed an amazing propaganda machine, effectively rallying war hawks behind their campaign to quite knowingly endanger the lives of millions of Chinese. The humiliation of China begins. Welcome back to Epic China. Lists of demands to be made on the Chinese had been circulating British politicians' offices even before the first shot was fired. The very first item demanded was the legalization of opium trade in China. Several months before the destruction of opium by Lin and the attack by the British, notable opium dealer James Matheson predicted what was to come and pointed out how foolish the Chinese were for trying to push back on the will of Britain to sell its illegal narcotics. In response to Lin's seizing of the opium chests, he proclaimed, "The Chinese have fallen into the snare of rendering themselves directly liable to the crown. I suppose war with China will be the next step." Soon thereafter, the British fired the first shot at the Battle of Kowloon. And months later, the British fired the first shot again at foreign traders and Chinese alike. Matheson was all too correct in his analysis. Britain was waging war on China. Warships had already been dispatched to China, expected to arrive in 1840. Though opium trading lobbyists had worked to influence the British government to act, the warships had been sent to punish China for its actions against the interests of Britain and would have been sent even without the lobbying. But the opium money couldn't wait for 1840. Here, now, early November of 1839, the British fully committed to the war they had created. It was a war specifically to enrich the British Empire with the deaths of Chinese, an opium war. The Chinese ships were utterly overwhelmed by the British attack. The battle could be summed up tersely with a single quote. The firing commenced at about 12, and at 1 they were all sunk, dispersed, or fleeing. The chastisement was severe. The Chinese reported only 13 deaths, though the British attested to 52 bodies brought to just one of the nearby towns. The British retreated to Macau to regroup. Meanwhile, Chinese erected cannons in Kowloon to protect from further attacks. The Daoguang Emperor focused on a practical-seeming approach to the rising tensions. Indeed, it was only the British who knew that this opium conflict had already escalated to war. He declared, "The English, ever since the opium interdiction, have been vacillating in their conduct. It is no longer consistent with dignity to continue to permit their trade. The trifle of customs duties is of no importance to us. Our dynasty, in conciliating foreigners, has shown kindness exceeding deep. But the English, instead of being grateful for this, have indulged in ferocious violence, so that they are in the wrong, whilst we are in the right, as all the world must know. Let, therefore, the English trade be at once stopped." Britain had been permanently banned from trade, so the Americans traded the British goods for them. Then, the practice of trading British items by other countries was also banned. As opium smuggling ceased, Chinese farmers throughout increased their production of the banned drug. Poppy fields expanded to the size of cities. Qing officials, meanwhile, reported that over half the opium smokers were already cured. One British estimate from this time, however, was that of over 12 million opium smokers, primarily being one-fifth of every Chinese man between the ages of 20 and 60. Realizing the majority of smokers were positioned in more southern provinces rather than spread evenly, we can only but imagine what percentage of those men encountered day to day were doomed from the great evil. In some places, certainly as high as a vast majority. Internally, the Chinese black market was beginning to break apart. Lin Zexu, upon hearing a local village had a stockpile of opium, dispatched soldiers to seize it. The town fought back, routing them. In response, he sent hundreds more with instructions to kill anyone who resisted and burn down every home. By the time the reinforcements arrived, the entire village had fled. The soldiers burned everything down, and a town once occupied by 1,000 people, many of whom had taken to opium smuggling, was simply erased from existence. Another edict against opium was released. They had come sporadically over the previous century. Then there were yearly, then monthly, and by this time it was nearly every single day opium was mentioned or focused on in edicts from the local and central government, published throughout Western newspapers, spread as warnings and proof of the seriousness of the situation. By June 1840, Lin Zexu heard reports of a force of British ships coming on the attack. He warned the emperor, who replied, "What can they do if we quietly wait on the defensive and watch their movements?" It's an understandable question and disposition. After all, China had, by Western estimates, a standing army of over 800,000 soldiers. But being logical and confident was not the correct stance, for China was in fact at the edge of an abyss. And though this fact eluded the Chinese high command, the British were quite aware of the potential long-term consequences of their war in China. In communications outlining the problems of China and how it should be forcibly reformed, we find one of the clearest and most accurate predictions about China the West has perhaps ever made. An attack from Britain may light the torch of civil war, and the Chinese provinces may once more be deluged with the blood of slaughtered millions. This is the possibility the British Empire confronted. They knew their battle to preserve opium sales may very well trigger a China-wide civil war, resulting in the deaths of millions of Chinese. But they decided it was a risk they were willing to take. The Chinese side continued with its microscopic reactions. Lin hunkered down and increased the defenses of Guangzhou. A bounty was put on the heads of the no longer welcome British. $20,000 was on offer for Charles Elliot's head alone, $200 for each white man, and $100 for each black man, as they were known to be of less value to the British. But in reality, few Chinese took the bounty seriously. No Chinaman will venture on earning the reward for killing an Englishman, partly from his natural timidity and partly from an apprehension that the Mandarins will evade paying the promised reward. The presence of foreigners in China was severely reduced, with only 6 remaining in all of Guangzhou by July of 1840. Famines were widespread, at around 4 per year on average. It's unknown if during this time period, 4 famines per year was much higher or lower rate than in ancient times, but such details meant little to those who starved to death, like those unfortunate souls in the Sichuan province. Demands were delivered to the Chinese Empire, repayment for the lost opium. Guangzhou, Xiamen, Dinghai, and Shanghai all needed to be open to trade. Foreign traders must be given equal treatment. China must pay Britain for the cost of war. No opium traders to be held accountable for opium dealing. And finally, there was to be no state control of trade itself. In 1840's China and Its Resources, author Robert Moody warned his readers about the peril of forcing China to adopt foreign values. In the early trade years, problems arose from Europeans intent on breaking the laws of China. The earliest European visitors who resorted to the Chinese seas for the purposes of trade traded most profitably and traded in peace. It was only in consequence of direct attempts to disobey the law or undermine the government that foreigners were ever treated with contempt or harshness by the Chinese. He wrote of the capitalist system, "This system, the Chinese do not understand. It is directly contrary to their system. They will not be schooled by any people on the face of the earth. Out of this determination, they cannot be reasoned. And therefore, as we know of neither justice nor possibility whereby even liberal principles can be forced upon even an individual, far less a great nation by coercive measures. The soundest policy for other nations to pursue is to leave them alone in possession of their system, however absurd it may appear, or however insulting it may be felt to those whose policy is grounded upon principles diametrically opposite. It's better to leave the Chinese alone with their system of doing things," he argued. But more striking and timelessly worded, in a quote that so closely mirrors my own personal views, he says of 1840 Chinese-European relations, "The foundation of all the misunderstandings that have taken place between the Chinese and European nations have arisen from attempts on the part of the latter to force their own systems upon the people of China in such a way as to undermine the Chinese government and institutions, or to compel the Chinese people to take part in and be governed by international law, such as it exists in Europe. This is manifest and palpable injustice, for as the Chinese have never come into any European country and demanded the alteration or the suspension of one title of the government or the institutions of that country, we know of no principle of justice or equity that can warrant any European nation going to China and demanding that any one title of the laws, the customs, or the practices of China should be altered upon their account for their benefit. The subject which we have now broached is by no means confined to China, for it applies equally to every people on the face of the earth, wherever they may be situated, and whatever may be the degree of their civilization or their savagism, in the opinion of Britons or any other nation. Our religion, our laws, and our observances may be better than those of any other people on the face of the earth, and whether they are so or not, it tends greatly to the tranquility and happiness of our country to think that they are so. But while we claim this to ourselves and profit by the claim, justice demands that we should allow the same to every other people, wherever they may reside, or by what name soever they may be called. This is a point worthy of the most careful consideration, and it is one which is deeply involved in all the misunderstandings we have had with the Chinese, and, we may add, in all the misunderstandings which nation has had with nation throughout the whole period of history." Few listened to this clear, sound advice. They knew better after all. Their way was right, while China's was wrong. But make no mistake about it. The British had nothing against the Chinese people, of course, only the Chinese government. It was only the oppressive, evil, and backwards government they detested. If anything, the British were doing a favor for the Chinese people by attacking them. And there was no shortage of Chinese traders, ready to turn against their own country, further justifying the British actions. The English were liberators, saviors of the backwards pagan Chinese. The Americans at this point strongly condemned the British actions and attitudes. The countries competed for leadership not just in terms of trade, might, and expansion, but also in terms of morality. American residents in China produced a scathing condemnation that was over 30 pages long, detailing what they viewed to be unjustifiable dispositions of the British Empire towards China. They highlighted and debunked Britain's excuses for opium smuggling and much, much more. All in all, it was America calling out Britain for its rampant, intentional, and unjustified violations of Chinese law and international norms. They went through the entire position of Britain's official drug cartel and dismantled it piece by piece. The Americans made a claim which demonstrated perfectly that leading moral high ground. Every peaceful resort must be exhausted before force is employed against China. Those peaceful attempts weren't to happen. British ships attacked port towns, battles and bombardments in Xiamen and a small island outside of Ningbo in Zhejiang province. They swept the coast, attacking and being attacked likewise. July 5th, 1840, British troops brought the fight from the southern provinces to the central, the inhabitants of which scarcely knew the name of Britain until they beheld their victorious armaments advancing before their defenseless homes. Zhoushan, near Shanghai, was not part of the usual British trade routes. The local military was weak, ill-prepared. The magistrate committed suicide as soon as the city fell, which it did almost immediately. The resistance was described as more ludicrous than terrifying. British forces had finally taken a city in China. They turned it into a confused scene of plunder and pillage. Every house was sacked. Citizens fled. Those who remained became servants of the crown. Soon, their poverty and want and greed led them to pillage as well. They even held fake funerals to pass valuables around in the coffins past the unsuspecting British rulers. On discovering the black market emerging, the new rulers shot down the offenders. A strange, uncomfortable norm emerged. The central government threatened any Chinese who dared assist the British, but locally the central government was powerless. Bounties on British soldiers' heads contrasted the profits to be made by trading goods with them. Attempts at ransoming those soldiers led to more public executions of the locals by the Brits. Peasants lived in fear, afraid of what their government would do to them for consorting with the British, and afraid of what the British would do to them for not providing provisions. The citizens shunned and avoided the invaders, who fell under fever and dysentery, longing for proper food. In desperation, they ate meat salted and cured in Calcutta that was green with putridity, and biscuits that were full of maggots and weevils. It was the first de facto British territory inside of China, and all it had been was looting, executions of Chinese people, and disease. Crimes by British soldiers were allowed to go unpunished, but woe unto the native of China who committed the same, for punishment was certain to await him. When Zhoushan was taken, our troops committed fearful excesses. The city of Dinghai was sacked, pillaged, and plundered, the officers in command being unable to restrain the men, inflamed by success and excited by alcohol. The scenes that were enacted are terrible to dwell upon and disgrace the name of Great Britain. Sickness, terror, death, and pain. This was life in British China. But free trade was once again established, primarily for opium. With those soldiers' bad experiences being sick while plundering and raping the city, and its distance from Guangzhou, Zhoushan fell out of favor with British strategists. They wanted somewhere familiar. They wanted somewhere more practical and directly valuable in their drug trade. And though the narrative in China was controlled entirely by the emperor, the British, rejected and dejected, had been busy building one of their own. As the beginnings of this conflict unfolded, so too did the primary competing narrative against China. For it is precisely at this time we begin to see the budding of a new narrative that would bloom among warmongers for centuries, the Canton Press. Once and for all, declare the Chinese government alone your enemy. Tell the people you will not injure a hair on their heads, and you will soon find that the Chinese government is weak and contemptible. This is how to overthrow China. Separate the government from the people. Exploit their differences. Create rifts. The message could be described simply as, we don't hate Chinese people, just the Chinese government. It began as British justifications for war. War to be waged, seeking unequal treatment, territorial expansion, and profits from death, justified by the pursuit of the ever-elusive concept of freedom. Also along the through line of anti-Chinese rhetorical rationale, Westerners promoted the direct blame for all of the country's problems on the government alone. Lin Zexu was faulted for rampant corruption and rising crime, contributing to the downfall of China and even theoretical future piracy. Long, scathing reports appeared in Western papers explaining why China's crackdown on opium was the real evil, not the opium itself. No, opium was hardly an issue at all. Puff piece articles about opium appealed to those looking for moral certainty. This one in the Canton Register tells the tale of a man reconnecting with an old friend. The old friend had been addicted to opium and was smoking enough to kill 30 people, according to a doctor's calculation. Rather than dying, however, the story says he looked younger and brisker than he did 10 years before. Front page articles sold the idea that opium was just like alcohol. Opium is the produce of the poppy, and ale and gin are the produce of barley, and these produce much the same effects. Turks take opium and they aren't addicted like the Chinese, it continued. Lots of Chinese people smoke opium without making beasts of themselves.
Like the Chinese do.
No man will venture to decide that inebriation by opium is in any one respect worse than inebriation from gin or brandy. And as to Lin Zexu's rule, it was represented as strict to the point of absurdity. No one was safe from his wrath. Of Lin's Guangzhou, the Canton Press gives a vivid description. The place is swarming with the commissioner's spies and informants. All the local authorities have received strict orders to search for traitorous locals who may have had the slightest connection with the English barbarians. The basest of men and the most fraudulent informants now have an abundant opportunity to fill their pockets and to ruin men of wealth and respectability. The prisons of Guangzhou are filled with a large number of helpless wretches, many of them entirely innocent. Even the most excellent citizens are led in chains to the dungeon and expire under torture, filth, and starvation. The mortality of the victims has recently been so great as to render the jail a morgue. What glory does this confer upon Lin's administration? China's government had, as soon as it cracked down on opium, suddenly become the tyrant of tyrants. China was terrifying, evil, and strong. But just as important as the fact that it was extremely strong and dangerous was the fact that it was extremely weak and powerless. Published just 1 week later, the flip side narrative emerged. It is not difficult to punish the Chinese or to make permanent arrangements for our future relations with the empire. China is the weakest nation on earth, and its people the most docile and unwarlike. Nothing has preserved the Chinese from foreign subjugation but the deserts, hordes, and semi-barbarous people that surround the land in every direction, with the sea and the absence of any enemy that would avail itself of the sea. That sea is open to us. We must proceed resolutely and do the work promptly and at once. James Matheson gave an account of China. The Chinese are a people characterized by a marvelous degree of imbecility, avarice, conceit, and obstinacy. Others explain to all who would listen that the trade in opium has not been a cause of rupture between Western governments and China. The cause is one, the Chinese assumption of a supremacy over us. Constant back and forth was taking place in British discourse, and it was clear that foreigners must either hold intercourse with them in strict accordance with their own laws and customs, or overturn their whole system by the sword. Though newspapers tried to convince the public otherwise, the evils of opium were never actually in any serious dispute. We have heard the opinion of thousands of Chinese, and they have always disproved and condemned smoking and trading opium. Among the foreigners, many, even of those engaged in the trade, do not hesitate to declare that it is an evil, and a great evil. Because China was so strong and powerful, weak and powerless, Western saviors needed to attack it as soon as possible. They didn't hate the Chinese people, those helpless wretches, those docile beasts. Not at all. They only hated the Chinese government. It was merely coincidence that those imbecilic beasts they cared about so much just happened to be the consumers of their deathly product. So too a coincidence that the enemy they waged war on just happened to be the primary stopping force in their opium trade. Few in the world understood the power of this beautifully crafted anti-Chinese narrative. Come to China to free the people from their oppressive government. Justify it through seemingly obedient news organizations running articles attacking the government for everything except the actual contentious issue, its stubborn attitude towards foreigners' right to profit from China. Magnify everything negative about the country, building support to hammer it with violence. So many Chinese imbeciles may die, but so many more will live to act as consumers in what may come next. A China subject to the rule of the far superior, civilized, expansionist British Empire. In those days, the very few Americans studying and pointing out these illegal actions being taken against the Chinese country had no ability to reach wide. They had no means to muster support by the Chinese, nor to truly have their message shared worldwide. Few Americans stood up to this kind of injustice, selflessly, on the side of the victimized Chinese, on the side of the rightful Chinese-created government, no matter how either could be judged. Very few Americans stand without significant personal benefit to give China the charitable, level-headed analysis it in fact deserves. Very few, indeed. Soon, we will see just what opportunity was lost without said broad public messaging. As China continues its weak, insufficient response to the invaders, who will begin their process of dismantling the country and bringing it to its knees. First order of business, force a concession of land, a safe haven for drug trafficking, and the imposition of Western values on the Chinese savages. Those values being servitude, opium dealing, and personal freedoms for the conquerors. Thanks, everyone. 谢谢.